My name is Dave Kung. I actually have several institutions right now. I teach at St. Mary's College of Maryland, where I'm a math professor. I'm also working for the MAA. I'm the director of MAA Project Next. I'm working for TIPSI Math, Transforming Post-Secondary Education in Mathematics, and I'm their director of strategy and implementation. When I was young, I always loved mathematics, and part of that was because both of my parents taught math. My father was a mathematician. My mom taught middle school math, and then she started teaching at the college level. So I grew up with, you know, two people who were teaching math and thinking about math all the time. And for some reason, you know, that really stuck for me, and it didn't for my two brothers. They went off to do other very non-math things. But I always loved math. You know, I was into the problems when I was as early as I can remember. I remember loving all the questions my teachers could throw at me, and that got me sort of accelerated really early. When did I know I wanted to become a mathematician? That's an interesting question. When I was growing up, I also played violin. I played a lot of violin. I started when I was a kid. And I really thought, I thought I wanted to be a professional musician. Sometime in high school, I went off to Interlaken, which is a, you know, fairly prestigious music camp for the summer. And what I learned at Interlaken was that there were people who really loved playing their instruments like 7, 8, 9 hours a day, and I was not one of them. And so what I learned there was that, you know, I think music was always going to be an avocation for me, and then something in the sciences was going to be my vocation. But then it wasn't until, you know, I did both mathematics and physics in college, and I wasn't sure which one I wanted to pursue. I had this course, a mechanics course with Don Cox. And I remember this really vividly. So it was on an exam, and he, you know, there were all these problems on the exam. And at the very bottom, it said, it may be useful to know that. And then he had this integral written out. And it was a sort of a complicated integral. It's like, you know, x squared over 1 plus c squared x squared. It was all this, you know, fairly complicated stuff. And what I remember is there was a sign involved. And I had no idea how to do the integral. But, you know, I got through the problem. I figured out where I needed to do the integral. And then I used the fact that he had put there. I got through it. And then when I handed my exam in, I said, you know, Professor Cox, you know, I used the integral. I don't really have a question. But my question is, like, how do you know that this is the integral? Like, how do you get this? Because it seems strange. And he said, you look it up in the table. And for me, that was this important moment. Like, for me, I cared where that integral came from. And for him, it was just a tool on the way to understanding physics better. And so that was sort of a moment I remember very vividly of like, oh, I think a little bit more like a mathematician than a physicist. So in terms of what kind of mathematics I like, you know, I'm going to talk a little bit about where I came from. So my PhD is in harmonic analysis. I really loved analysis when I was a student. It sort of made sense to me. I kind of loved the fact that it was a little bit messy, but things worked out in the end. And so I loved the analysis, and I went through, and my PhD was in harmonic analysis with Andreas Seeger at the University of Wisconsin. And quickly after that, I knew I wanted to move away from theoretical mathematics and move toward mathematics education. And so my scholarship moved toward mathematics education. And there I was really interested in the knowledge you need in order to teach certain subjects. And so what knowledge do you need in order to teach calculus well? And I mean this especially in sort of a modern way where we're interacting with students, where our classes are active, where we're really uncovering student thinking. When that's really important, then you need more knowledge of the mathematics. If you're just going to stand there and lecture, you might only need to know the mathematics. But you really need to know more about student thinking. And so that was some of my work in mathematics education. Since then, you know, I've done a lot of other work, but it's been more about professional development. But sort of all along the same vein, in that, you know, I'm still concerned about student thinking and about teacher knowledge of student thinking. Just last year, a colleague and I came out with a book called What Could They Possibly Be Thinking? Understanding Your College Math Students. And it's sort of a tour through mathematics education literature. We look at lots of different examples from the literature of students understanding, and maybe understanding in sort of not quite the same way that mathematicians understand, but then what that reveals about their understanding and how you can utilize that in the classroom. And so it's a tour of all undergraduate mathematics from this perspective of what sort of mistakes students make when they're thinking about math. So that's sort of been my trajectory, but now I'm working a lot more in the areas of professional development and policy, which is incredibly interesting and very fun, but a very different challenge from back in the days when I was thinking about hard theoretical math and doing harmonic analysis. So I definitely had moments during my career when I really struggled, and I struggled a lot, in the last year finishing my thesis especially. And if you had talked to me at that point, I would have told you all about these struggles. But, you know, with a little bit more perspective and a few more years and getting to know a lot more mathematicians, what I really think hard about is the fact that I don't think I struggled nearly as much as most people in mathematics. You know, when I think about it, I had almost every advantage possible to try to get a great career going in mathematics. Both of my parents taught mathematics. My father had a PhD in the subject. I grew up with great teachers. I'm a half Asian guy. My teachers thought, you know, they heard before that I was good in math. They were had preconceived notions about me being good at math. You know, even through into my career, I think I was probably more likely to get invited for speaking gigs, more likely to be, you know, invited to conferences and to talk to different people. I think all of that, I've just benefited from, you know, from one thing after another in getting to where I am in my career. And I think it's really important for those of us who benefit from these privileges to acknowledge them and to not sort of go along with this fiction that we're living in a meritocracy where, like, we work really hard and we overcame these struggles to get where we are. You know, that might be the truth in parts, and it certainly felt like it was a struggle. But compared to other people, you know, I've had a really easy time getting to where I am. And I think it's just incredibly important to acknowledge that. You know, when I think of the things I'm proudest of, you know, things that I might be well known for, you know, working with Project Next or just recently earning a HIMO award. You know, the things that I really feel most proud of are some things, you know, I did with individual students at St. Mary's. So, you know, early on in my career, we saw that students from minoritized groups were much more likely to fail out of calculus. And we did something about it. You know, I had worked with an Uri Treisman style program when I was in graduate school. And so I knew how to set up such a program, and we did. I was lucky to have a colleague, Catherine Socha, who was willing to join me. And we started an emerging scholars program. And when I look back in those first few years, we had a number of great students who all the history, all the statistics suggest that if we hadn't done something better, they would have sort of joined all these ranks of students who had great promise but didn't make it through the system. So I'm really proud that, with my colleagues, we could fix the system at least enough so that more of those students were making it through. I've just had an enormous number of great role models, starting with my parents who both did mathematics. I remember really well my geometry teacher when I was in middle school, who was just fantastic. His name was Jim Belter. I just got back in touch with him to thank him for everything he did for me. And Mrs. Hetzler as well when I was back in middle school. But, you know, looking further down that road, Uri Treisman, who is, you know, a MacArthur Genius Grant winner, he runs the Dana Center down at the University of Texas at Austin. He's really been a great mentor and an inspiration to me. You know, a lot of his work is about making sure opportunities are available to everyone. And his programs were really sort of a turning point for me in understanding that all students can succeed in the mathematics that we're providing. And it's really the systems that we have them in, the social forces that keep them from succeeding. And that's part of our responsibility as educators, is to make sure that we either make sure that the social forces are there pushing them in the right direction, or sort of manufacture those forces so that they get the same advantages that other students have. So he's been a real inspiration to me and a real mentor for me. I think there's this perception for students of mathematics, especially graduate students, that there's sort of one future, and that the best future is a job at a research institution where you're producing the next generation of fantastic mathematicians. And if you miss that a little bit, at least you can get a job at like a four-year school, like maybe not the state's flagship school, but one of the smaller ones. Or maybe you can go to a liberal arts job and you know, teach a little bit more. And like further down this sort of mythical totem pole, like further down, there's like a, you know, two-year jobs, or heaven forbid, going out into industry, right? And there's like this hierarchy of these positions. And I just think it's BS, like all of it. Like this, the fact that there's a hierarchy, like there are a million different things you can do with a degree in mathematics. And what I wish people were better at getting across to students, and what I wish people had gotten across to me, is that there's this huge array of things you can choose from, and they're all great. And what the key is to figure out what path works well for you, right? And so it's not like trying to get the best job possible and then fight like hell to get tenure there and all of that. It's more of a question of, what do you want your life to be like? Like, what do you want to do? What are you really motivated to do? Is that teaching? You know, is that something in finance? You know, whatever you're really motivated to do, why don't you find a place within the mathematics community where that's valued, and then go for that as a job and a career? Because that would make for not just sort of a happier life, but you'll be more productive because you're going to be doing something that you really love. So that's what I wish people had told me when I was younger. And I wish we could get that word out, that there's a huge array of options out there for you. Find something that's going to be good for you and pursue that.